Hello, hello, hello. Good afternoon, good Wednesday afternoon, wherever you are all over the world. It might be morning, it might be afternoon, but it is Wednesday. So happy Wednesday to you, family, community. What is going on? I hope that today has found you well and in perfect peace. Sheena here with another word. Okay, at the Transformation Hub, where we equip and empower believers of Jesus Christ to lead and live transformed from renewed minds and restored souls. So that is the mission here. That is the mandate. I hope that everyone is doing well. I do have a word for you. The Lord put this word in my presence and in my spirit probably a few weeks ago. By way of numbers, okay? So we all have prayer watches. My prayer watch is normally 12 a.m. to 3 p.m. But the Lord, in all of his sovereignty and goodness, okay, began to wake me up a couple of weeks ago at 4:23, okay? Every time I would look at my phone, it would be exactly 4:23 a.m. And so me, being me, I'm like, okay, my watch is from 12 to 3, 12 a.m. to 3 a.m., right? But now here it is, I'm waking up at 4:23. So I knew that the Lord was trying to get a message to me. And I do feel like that this is for you all as well. Of course, take it to the Lord for confirmation, for further clarity, for more revelation, for more insight. But this is a word that is going to be filled with prophetic instruction as well as warning. So if this word applies to you, just like every other prophetic word, you want to take it to the Lord. But this is prophetic instruction and prophetic warning, because we are crossing over, period. Okay, period. That's the end of the statement. We are crossing over. We are to the time where we are getting ready to transition, and the enemy wants to throw fiery darts. He wants to throw obstacles in our way, one being the spirit of offense, which I will touch on here in this live today. But today we're going to talk about guarding our hearts. Guarding our hearts, okay? Because that is so important for where we're getting ready to go. But before we fully possess the promises of God, before we fully step into the goodness and sovereignty that God has for us in this season, the restitution, the restoration, he wants us to be intentional with guarding our hearts, okay? So I'll go ahead and get started. 4:23, like I stated, I was waking up and I was seeing it. I was asking the Lord, what do you mean with 4:23? So the Lord does talk to me through numbers, because God is the God of all creation. He created numbers, so he can talk through numbers. Our job as believers of Jesus Christ is not to get on Google and search out what does this and that mean, because what pops up on Google is angel numbers, and angel numbers come from a source that is not the Holy Spirit. So that's a lie for another time. But 4:23, I know that the Lord was trying to get something to me. He was trying to tell me something. And so what dropped in my spirit is I pressed in for more revelation and insight to what 4:23 is, because that's what time I kept waking up. Every time I looked at my phone, it was 4:23. He revealed to me Proverbs 4:23. And it makes sense, okay? So Proverbs 4:23, guard your heart. This is a prophetic instruction, prophetic warning. Take heed, okay? Proverbs 4:23. Keep your heart with all diligence, for out of it spring the issues of life. Keep your heart with all diligence, for out of it spring the issues of life. So we're going to talk about keep your heart with all diligence. Okay, and why do we need to keep our heart with all diligence? We're believers. Why do we need to guard our hearts? Shouldn't God be doing that? Well, this is one of the instances where God gives us an assignment, okay? He gives us the will to guard our hearts. And so guarding our hearts doesn't mean that we have a wall up so high that nothing can come in. His goodness, his promises, that's not what it means. It means guarding your heart, okay? It means putting a guard over your heart, taking security of what you're allowing in, okay? Guarding your heart, okay? Your heart is high, like a high security building, right? At when you go to governmental buildings, they have security outdoors even before you can come in and go through the metal detectors and sign your name to come in, right? Same instance here. Guard your heart. Be intentional in discerning and what you are allowing into that private and secure space. So in this, we want to use wisdom. And since wisdom belongs in the midst of the heart, it is also necessary to keep the heart in the sense of guarding it. The heart should be kept for wisdom, guarding it against the way of the wicked. And I'm going to repeat that because that is so pivotal, especially in this hour. The heart should be kept for wisdom, not worldly wisdom, not what JoJo and Nate and them said, not what your mama and your cousin and your daddy and them said. But when we're talking about wisdom, we're talking about the wisdom of God, okay? Okay? There is wisdom in revering and having a holy reverence for God. Somebody, I need you to catch that quickly, okay? Because this is not the hour to allow just anybody to speak into your life. You are on the brink of your breakthrough, and it is imperative that you have godly wisdom at the forefront of your heart to guard it from the wicked. The wicked meaning some people that are on agenda, unfortunately, the spirit operating in them is on agenda from the camp of the enemy to throw you off course so that you cannot retrieve the promises of God. But some people unintentionally don't know that what they're feeding you and what they're trying to speak into your life about your certain circumstance that God is getting ready to resurrect and turn around, they don't know that the information that they're giving you is not of God. So the heart should be kept for wisdom. This is godly wisdom. This is not worldly wisdom. This is why we have to get back into a heart posture in a position of repentance and having a reverence for God, okay? The heart should be kept for wisdom, guarding it against the way of the wicked, okay? Especially from the perspective, if we look at the New Covenant, if we look at the New Testament, Ezekiel 36 and 26 tells us that God will take our stony hearts and give us a new heart of flesh. So if we look at it from that perspective, the promise is a new heart. The promise is a new heart. If we allow God to do that supernatural heart surgery, to take that heart of stone from the trauma, from the childhood pain, okay, from the breakdown of relationships, from disappointments in the past, okay? If we allow him to take the heart of stone and give us a heart of flesh, we definitely want to be intentional with guarding our hearts because it's a new heart now. It's a new heart. It's a resurrected heart. It's a revived heart in the name of Jesus. So a new heart is worth guarding. The heart, if we look at it in the aspect of a reservoir, okay? Change has to happen there and it has to begin there. So the Bible tells us in Romans 12, be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. The Bible uses the mind and the heart interchangeably. So change starts to happen in the heart. Yes, it can happen in the mind with the thought process, but your thoughts lead to emotions. Your heart is the seat of your emotions. Okay, yeah, I'm teaching good here today. I need y'all to catch this, okay? Because this is going to set you free from any demonic agenda that is trying to come up and deceive you, to throw you off from your destiny. This is not the hour. This is not the hour for that, okay? So I'm gonna keep going. The heart is the reservoir and the change must begin there. So if your reservoir is polluted, that means that the pipes, the valves are no good, okay? The Bible tells us and warns us to avoid a double heart, to avoid a hard heart, to avoid a proud heart, and to totally dismantle away from an unbelieving heart. A cold heart and an unclean heart. And I'm going to repeat that. The Bible warns us to avoid a double heart, and that's in Psalm 12 and 2. The Bible warns us to avoid a hard heart, that's in Proverbs 28 and 14. The Bible warns us to avoid a proud heart, that's Proverbs 21 and 4. The Bible warns us to avoid an unbelieving heart, that is Hebrews 3 and 12. The Bible warns us to avoid a cold heart, Matthew 24 and 12. And the Bible warns us to avoid an unclean heart, and that is in Psalm 51 and 10. That's your homework. Look up those scriptures. Meditate on them. Okay? Meditate on them. So, Proverbs 4 and 23. Keep your heart with all diligence. Okay? What is diligence? What does that look like? What does that mean? This implies that it isn't easy to guard or keep one's heart, which is why God is telling us to keep it with all diligence. He could have just said, guard your heart and moved on. But he said to guard your heart with all diligence because he knew that it would be a job, that it would be an assignment, that it is something that we would have to discern. Hear me by the Spirit, something that we would have to discern of what we're letting in, okay? Of what we're letting in. So that means there will be opportunities that come up to give our heart to a person or to a path that wisdom will warn against, okay? Which is why we have to keep it with all diligence. Because there will be opportunities where the opposition will try to come in and pollute and poison your heart. Hear me by the Spirit. There will be opportunities, okay, where the opposition will try to come in and destroy what God is trying to build for your destiny. There will be opportunities. But that doesn't mean that you have to take the bait, which is why we have to keep it with all diligence and be discerning. Okay, so if a heart is captured, that means that the whole man has been captured, which means, again, I told you the heart is the seat of the emotions, right? This is where the affections, the desires, the motives, the pursuits are handled. Okay, and if the opposition comes in and tries to disrupt what God is trying to build for your destiny, what God is trying to reveal to you for your destiny, guess what? You will be derailed. And today I decree and declare that the weapons may form, but they will not prosper, because God is increasing you in the gift of discerning of spirits. The Bible tells us that we can freely ask for wisdom. Ask for wisdom and he will give it to us. So God, we're praying for an increase in godly wisdom. We strip ourselves, our minds, our hearts of the wisdom of the world, and we fully surrender and submit to your wisdom in the name of Jesus. For out of it springs the issues of life. So there is a great reward to the one who guards their heart, keeping it for wisdom. There is a great reward. And many of you are getting ready to step into your season of reward, hallelujah, by the glory of God, because you have kept your heart. When the enemy wanted to shoot fiery darts to harden your heart by the way of the enemy's plots and schemes, you fell on your face and you repented, even though the offense was against you. Hear me by the Spirit. When you guard your heart with the wisdom of God, there will be a reward. No matter what they've done to you, no matter what the enemy sent your way to derail you, hear me by the Spirit that your reward will be great in God. If you keep wisdom, if you guard your heart with wisdom and not the way of the wicked, in the name of Jesus. So those that keep their heart for wisdom, they enjoy life flowing from their heart. They enjoy life more abundantly from their heart. Okay? It is like a spring of pleasant and bountiful water. Fresh and crisp water, okay? Thirst quenching water, okay? The unguarded heart sees a choking or a restriction to the joy and pleasantness of life. So you know the saying, misery loves company. Just think back on those individuals who you detached from due to the obedience of God. Let's keep it real. God has removed some people from your life because he's going to replace them, and the reward is going to be rich. Anything that God replaces, he removes, he replaces it, okay? And it will be rich. It will have value. It will have worth. Somebody needed to hear that. You've been toiling and you've been wondering why your relationship's falling apart, but God needed to separate you. He needed to set you apart. And that which he removes, he is going to replace, and the reward will be rich. Receive it. Receive it by the Spirit in the name of Jesus. So the unguarded heart, those people that were miserable, that were toxic, those that you tried to pour into, and they just did not seem to get right, and they mocked you, and you thought they were mocking you, but they were really mocking God, the God in you, okay? They see it's a choking or a restriction of the joy and the pleasantness of life. They cannot enjoy life. They might even have more than you, but they still can't enjoy life. They might be further along than you, but they still cannot enjoy life, okay? Because out of it springs the issues of life. And they can't enjoy life, okay? And it's an unguarded heart because they allow everything and anything to come in. And they just can't simply enjoy life. Okay, so one of the great enticements to the way of the wicked is that it is fun, pleasant, and will bring some sense of happiness, okay? And this is referring to those individuals that take a direction that is determined to derail them from their destiny by way of their heart. They allow instant gratification to derail them from their destiny. Okay, hear me by the Spirit. They allow instant gratification. It's instant and it's temporary, but they would rather bask in the instant and temporary than delay gratification so that they can see the fulfillment of the promises of God, so that they can go in and possess the land. And so that's where their wicked heart is coming from. And that's where they're making choices. Okay, because again, if the heart is not right, okay, nothing else is right. Everything is polluted. There is poison running through the bloodstream because the heart is not right. Okay? And so though guarding your heart with all diligence may seem, okay, that it may mean that there is a saying of temporary pain. Okay, because if you think about it, anybody who's gone through inner healing, anybody who has had to detach from those relationships and those individuals that you really, truly love and desire to see the best for them, there is a level of pain to our obedience. But the purpose on the other side of the breakthrough, my God, somebody needs to hear that. You are about to see the other side of the pain that you experience, and it's going to catapult you further into your purpose, and that pain will be no more. That level of pain that you experience from that situation, from that circumstance, from that relationship, from that oppression, from that bondage, you will never see pain on that level again because you chose to guard your heart. You kept a repentant and pure heart, even in the midst of the warfare. And God is getting ready to reward you in the mighty and matchless name of Jesus. It is the wellspring of life in that the capacity to live with joy ultimately comes from within and not from the circumstances. Somebody needs to hear that again. It is the wellspring of life in that the capacity to live life with joy ultimately comes from within and not from one's circumstances, okay? The corrupt heart draws one down to the grave, but wisdom protects the heart from that corruption. Wisdom protects the heart from that corruption. The wisdom of God, not the wisdom of this world. The wisdom of God protects. So when you hear, and hear me by the Spirit on this, because this is another live for another time, but this is what the time and seasons that we're in. Many of you have been under ministries or been in communities where they have literally been trying to tickle your fancy, hype you up by giving you words that will make you feel good. But we are in an hour and we are in a season, okay, where there are going to be prophetic warnings to correct you. And if your heart is not right, unfortunately, you will fall into the pit of corruption. So hear me by the Spirit. Hear me by the Spirit. Be open to correction. Be open to rebuke. The Bible tells us that God chastens those whom he loves. If he stops chastening you, never do I want to ever feel that, because that means that his presence is no longer there. You want to be chastened. Allow him to allow vessels, holy vessels, pure vessels, that are coming to you in love to correct you, to get you back on the path, to get you back in alignment with the perfect will of God for your life. It is for your good. It is not for your bad. And even though the word might hurt a little bit, guess what? It's better than falling into the pit of corruption. So be open to prophetic warnings, be open to correction, be open to rebuke. It is God's way of showing that he loves you. He chastens those whom he loves. So if you grew up fatherless, hear me by the Spirit. This is not the hour. You need to get that healed up. If you grew up in a childhood trauma environment, you need to get that healed, because God is sending forth his pure vessels to correct the body of Christ, to get them back into alignment. Okay, and we each have a part to play in the body. So we need everyone to be healed, healthy, and whole in the mighty and matchless name of Jesus. This is not the hour, okay, to allow that father wound to sever and bleed on those who God is sending to help you. This is not the time to allow that mother wound, hear me by the Spirit, to come up and bleed on those who God is calling to help you to heal and recover all. This is not the time, hear me by the Spirit. God is sending his pure vessels forth with a word in their mouth, with a pure heart, to deliver you from that which is derailing you from your destiny. And if you choose to be disobedient and disregard the word, you're going to miss out. You're going to be derailed. You're going to be in the pit of corruption. Your heart will be polluted and poisonous. And you're going to look around you and wonder what is going on. Why is everybody else getting blessed? And when I talk about blessings, this is far bigger than material. You understand? This is abundance. This is healing in the body. This is health in the soul. This is soul restoration. This is renewal of relationships that the enemy came in to disrupt. You want to be open to rebuke, to correction, and to the warnings of God's vessels. In Jesus' name, okay? So we don't want pollution in our hearts. We don't want poison in our hearts, which is why the word tells us in Proverbs 4:23 to guard our hearts above all else. Guard our hearts above all else with diligence. Guard your heart. Guard your heart, okay? And this is what the Spirit of the Lord put on my heart. So yes, he did tell me to come forth with this word of guarding your heart. But here are the instructions. But before I get to the instructions, I do want to prophetically encourage and speak this word over somebody, over more than one of you all. I believe that it's important to guard your heart, because God is getting ready to send back people, okay, who you had to detach from. And you had to detach from them because God needed to show you who you were and God needed to show them who they were. And now God is getting ready to send them back to your life. And you're going to know this because there's going to be multiplication. You're going to have a grace to not only you've forgiven that person, they've forgiven you, okay? The Bible tells us to forgive 70 times 7. Every time that incident, every time that offense, every time that trauma rose up, you chose to forgive. My God, that's for somebody. And God is going to reward you. And he's bringing some people back. And they're going to be a blessing. And you're going to be a blessing to them. But hear me by the Spirit. The reason why you have to guard your heart is because there's going to be individuals who cannot discern in the realm of the Spirit, and they're going to try to derail you from resetting those relationships. They're going to look, and these people are stuck in the past, so therefore they want to keep you stuck in the past. Like this word said, they want to bring you back. They want to take you down to the grave, okay? Because that's what a corrupt heart does. A heart that does not operate from the wisdom of God. It is corrupt. It is wicked. And they want to bring you down there to wallow with them. But hear me by the Spirit, that will not be your portion, because we've prayed for an increase in wisdom. Your gift of discerning of spirits is increasing, even as I'm on this live right now in the name of Jesus. Even as I'm talking, God is pouring in revelation and insight and wisdom. And he's even revealing to you these people that he's bringing back. Some of you already know who they are. Some of you don't. But hear me by the Spirit. It's not a tactic from the enemy. When God stamps it, it's a prophetic seal on it. And he needs this relationship to come back, to be reset. Because it's going to be one of redemption. His redemptive power. Hallelujah. His resurrecting power. Hallelujah. Hear me by the Spirit, okay? So that's for somebody. God is resetting relationships, but you have to be able to discern that which he's resetting versus those that are corrupt and are still counterfeits. You will know them by their fruits, and these people are going to come back with a repentant heart, and you're going to be able to repent. I believe the word says in James, confess your sins one to another, so that that's going to bring healing. And that's how you guys are going to know God is doing this thing again. For some of you, keep forgiving individuals who really try to crush you and put you down. But that doesn't mean to reconcile with everybody. But for some of you, and you will know, that's why you have to take this word to the Lord for confirmation to see if this word is for you. He is going to reset some very pivotal relationships that are mandatory for your destiny, okay? And you don't want to miss the mark on that in the name of Jesus. Now, this is what the Lord instructed me. He has told us that we need to examine our hearts for the following. This is what we need to examine our hearts for. Number one, self-righteousness, okay? Self-righteousness. A self-righteous person thinks that they can do no wrong, and they go about with a holier-than-thou attitude, judging, scrutinizing everyone else. They have a show attitude of someone who strongly believes in the rightness of his or her own actions or opinions. A lot of these people are deceived. A lot of self-righteous people are in deception, and they are full of pride, okay? But that's why God is warning us, that he's instructing us and he's warning us that these are prayer points that we need to pray and we need to stay low, because at any time the enemy can throw something our way and we can fall into self-righteousness as well. But I decree and declare that that won't be our portion, because God, we're asking for a humble heart. Humble us, convict us immediately, and allow us, Lord, okay, to be quick to obey, to the conviction, to the direction, so that we do not fall into these pits, okay? In the name of Jesus. So self-righteousness is one, okay? Self-righteousness is one that we have to examine our hearts for. Biblically speaking, righteousness is about being in right standing with God. We're in right standing with God, okay? And we're in right standing because we have a repentant heart every day in the name of Jesus. Unintentional sin and intentional sin, get in the habit of repenting daily. Okay, a self-righteous person recognized as giving final authority for one's decisions, not to God, but to oneself. So we want to examine our hearts for self-righteousness and repent, okay? Number two, pride. Pride. The spirit of Leviathan and his scales, that's in Job, okay? 41, I believe. Read up on Leviathan, but pride, okay? Pride at the root is fear and anxiety for some people, okay? We have to humbly rest in God's sovereignty. We have to stay low. We cannot allow pride to throw us off from possessing the promises of God, okay? Pride is another thing we have to examine our hearts for and repent. Number three, entitlement. Entitlement. And entitlement ties to pride. But examine your heart for entitlement and we repent. Ingratitude. Ingratitude. Because we've been disappointed for so long, for some of us, that we have this hardness in our hearts. But today, I pray, I stand in proxy for those that have ingratitude in their heart by way of disappointment from things that they feel like will never, ever come to pass. God, I pray that you will strip your sons and daughters of ingratitude, of hardened hearts, of stony hearts, of pride, of self-righteousness, God, in the name of Jesus. We rebuke and bind entitlement, self-righteousness. We rebuke and bind ingratitude, God, and we loose your love and your peace and your understanding. Even when we don't understand, and I feel this for somebody, that's why I'm hovering here. Even when we don't understand what God is doing, and we feel like in our hearts that, God, where are you? The promise should be here. It should be made manifest. I've prayed, I've toiled, I've travailed, I've groaned. Where is the promise? What are you doing? No, we don't want that type of an attitude. We want to get in the posture and in the position to thank God because it's on the way. If he put the desire in your heart and you truly have been contending from a pure place, guess what? That promise is on its way. He is not a man that he shall lie. That promise is on the way. His word will not return to him void. His promise is on the way. So you need to come out of that place of ingratitude and begin to fall on your face and thank God from a posture of thankfulness. Worship him, not for what he can do, but for who he is. I feel that for somebody. Worship him for who he is, and that will begin to put gratitude back into your heart, okay? We don't want to be lord of our own life. God has an agenda. And we trust his agenda, even when it's not in our timing that we feel like, okay, God, it should be here now. No, nope. His perfect timing is what we want. His perfect will is what we want in the name of Jesus. Examine your heart for people pleasing. This is not the time to people please. When God puts a word in your mouth and you've prayed over it and he's telling you how to apply that word and you need to speak it, go forth. This is not the time for people pleasing. This is not the time for people pleasing. The fear of God shall outweigh your fear of man and what they're going to say or what they're going to think. Over are the days of people pleasing. Rise up in the name of Jesus. Prayerlessness is another thing we need to examine our hearts for. What is your prayer life like? The Bible tells us to pray without ceasing. Yes, we have to work. Yes, we have to do homework with our kids. But what is your prayer life like? Breath prayers can be said all day long. Thank you, Jesus. That is a prayer. Worship is a prayer and a supplication to God. What is your prayer life like? Okay? Examine your heart. Repent. Hypocrisy. Don't just be a hearer of the word, be a doer of the word. And make sure, Come on, I sense this for somebody, that you're not falling into the trap of being a hypocrite, that you are truly bearing witness to the Spirit and you live what you're speaking, because people are looking at you, whether or not you know it. There are unbelievers. There are people that the enemy has sent on assignment that is waiting for you to stumble and trip up so they can try to throw you off course. Okay? So make sure you are living pure and holy. Thank you, Holy Spirit. God's standard is still pureness and holiness. So we do not want to be hypocrites. In the name of Jesus, we want to practice what we preach. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for that. Examine your heart for that, okay? Examine your heart for any type of hypocrisy in the name of Jesus. The next thing is rebellion. Rebellion and disobedience. Examine your heart. Examine your heart. Examine your heart for rebellion and disobedience, because you don't want to fall into that subtle trap of witchcraft. You don't want to fall into that subtle trap of witchcraft by self-will. Hear me, somebody, by the Spirit. I rebuke and bind that spirit of witchcraft in the name of Jesus. And I decree and declare that rebellion and disobedience will no longer be your portion, but you will allow the Lord to be Lord over your life, Lord and Savior. You confess Him with your mouth, believe it in your heart, and let Him be Lord over your life in the name of Jesus. Okay. Last but not least, and this is a big one, and I see how the enemy is trying to come with this one. Okay. Part of my mandate and my assignment is to expose the tactics of the enemy. So you want to examine your heart for offense. For offense. You hear me? You want to examine your heart for offense. Offense. The spirit of offense. I believe we can learn to guard our hearts against offense with the help of the Holy Spirit. So Holy Spirit, help us to guard our hearts against the spirit of offense. We do not want to be easily offended. We pray that offense would easily roll off of our shoulders in the name of Jesus. This is not the hour to be easily offended. Don't allow the opposition to offend you because of the corrupt and wickedness in their hearts. Do you hear me by the Spirit? Do you hear me by the Spirit of God? This thing is serious. The enemy is angry because the kingdom suffers violence, but the violent take it by force. He sees that God's sons and daughters have rose up in their faith. And he does not want to see these promises come to pass. He does not want to see these relationships reconciled. He does not want to see wealth transfers. And when I talk about wealth, I'm talking more than money. I'm talking about the wealth transfer of generational love. I'm talking about the wealth transfer of generational healing. I'm talking about the wealth transfer of generational deliverance. I'm talking about the wealth transfer of generational blessings. Okay, this thing is bigger than money. It's bigger than money. I'm talking about the wealth transfer of abundance. I'm talking about the wealth transfer of 5 to 10 generations after you being saved because of what you're doing in this hour. Come on here. Somebody hear me by the Spirit. Somebody hear me by the Spirit. Offense is a big one. And the way that the enemy is doing this is he is targeting, he's using people close to you, okay, to bring offense, because their hearts are not right, because they're corrupt in their hearts, because they are wicked in their hearts, because they don't have the wisdom of God, because they don't have a reverence for God. And he's bringing these people, okay, the enemy is using the spirit of offense in these people to throw you off and detour you. But I decree and declare today that your head is on straight, that your head is in the game, that you will not allow those which the enemy is using close to you to derail you from your destiny. You will cross over and possess the land in the mighty and matchless name of Jesus. You will cross over into the good and great land, the good and large land, the land that flows with milk and honey. And no devil in hell can stop it in the name of Jesus. in the mighty and matchless name of Jesus. And if you stay obedient to God, thank you, Holy Spirit. If you stay obedient to him, he will reveal the motive of these people. The reason they're able to trick you up is because you don't want to detach from them. Oh, because that's family. Oh, because that's my cousin and them. Oh, because we've been friends since second grade. But when you're obedient to the leading of the Holy Spirit, when God tells you, I need you to detach from this individual because they are bringing toxins and they are polluting your heart and your spirit and your soul, I need you to detach and I need you to do it immediately. Guess what? You're not going to question God, because like I stated earlier, that which God removes, he replaces. And it will be a reward that will be rich and full of value and worth in the mighty and matchless name of Jesus. So this is where that obedience ties in. This is where that trust. God, I don't know what you're doing in my relationships. It hurts. I can't call on nobody. Where are my people? God is sending your people, hallelujah, in the mighty and matchless name of Jesus. Hear me by the Spirit. He is sending divine connections. He is sending mission mates. He is sending purpose partners that will help you to prevail in your purpose and push you forward into destiny in the name of Jesus. Hear me by the Spirit. Glory, hallelujah. We thank you, God. Because what he strips, it might be painful, but he needs to do it in this season for what he's getting ready to send. And I sense this for somebody so strongly. You've been toiling because you've been going back and forth. God, what are you doing in my relationships? But I hear the Spirit of the Lord saying, I am stripping them, because where I'm getting ready to take you into this new season, they can't go because they will sabotage it. But hear me by the Spirit of the Lord. God is saying, I'm going to settle you in every area, and that includes your relationships, in the mighty and matchless name of Jesus. Glory, hallelujah. De shatabaso koro romosha. Glory, hallelujah. Examine your heart for offense. And this is subtle, because if you take the bait, then you fall into the trap of offense. Let that thing roll off of your shoulder. Any perceived offense, write it down. Pray for unforgiveness immediately. Forgive them. The Bible tells us 70 times 7. And forgiveness is not about them. It's for you, so that you're not poisoned and polluted in your heart. Because what God is getting ready to do, I wish you could see what I see in the realms of the Spirit. It's a land that is flowing with milk and honey. Do you hear me? It's going to far. It's going to outweigh. Okay? The former. It's going to outweigh, but you have to finish this last process. Let him prepare your heart. Examine your heart. Examine your heart. Examine your heart. Examine your heart for offense. Examine your heart for unforgiveness. Repent for every perceived offense. Lord, help us to forgive. Help us to let offense roll off of our backs quickly, in the mighty and matchless name of Jesus. Examine your heart, and this is the last thing, for any residue from past seasons of trauma. Any residue from past seasons of trauma. Don't allow the enemy to trick you up for all the healing, the inner healing, the deliverance that you went through for your past traumas. Don't allow the enemy to throw any obstacles in your way. Okay? Residue from past traumas. Psalm 26 and 2 tells us, examine me, O Lord, and prove me. Try my mind and my heart. Examine me, O Lord, and prove me. Try my mind and my heart. That is Psalms 26 and 2. That should be your daily meditation, your daily prayer. Examine me, O Lord, and prove me. Try my mind and my heart. Psalm 26 and 2. Okay? So those are the things that you want to examine your heart from. Lastly, this is how to guard your heart. This is the prophetic instruction on how to guard your heart. Stay rooted and grounded in Christ. Bear witness to the fruit of the Spirit. The fruit of the Spirit is in Galatians. There are 9 of them. Stay rooted and grounded in Christ and bear witness to the fruit of the Spirit. Number 2, forgiveness. Okay, one of the powerful things that you can do when you feel perceived offense is to forgive, and forgive quickly. Don't let that thing simmer in your spirit. You have to get to the place of forgiveness and do it quickly. Okay, and hear this. Majority of the time, offense is just a misunderstanding or an accident. Sometimes the person doesn't even know that they have offended you. Let it go and forgive. And even when people are intentionally offending you by way of the spirit that the enemy is using in them, when they are intentionally offending you, still forgive. Forgiveness frees you from the pollution and the poison in your spirit and in your soul. Don't allow the actions of others to contaminate you. There is too much at stake in this hour. Don't allow the actions of others to contaminate you. There is too much at stake in this hour. Forgive 70 times 7. That's what the Bible tells us. Forgive 70 times 7. Every time that offense comes up, forgive 70 times 7. Every time that past trauma comes up, forgive 70 times 7 so that your Father in heaven can forgive you. Stay low. Stay low is the third thing. Stay low. Remain humble. Don't allow pride to creep up and take you out. Stay low. Stay low. Remain humble. Number 4, die daily. Die to your flesh daily. When your flesh wants to rise up, command it to die. You are subjected to the Spirit of God. Submit to the Holy Spirit. Submit to God and his ways. Tell your flesh that it has to die. Number 5, pray about any perceived offenses and pray for any perceived offenders. Bless those with your words. Do not curse them. Pray for them. Cover them. And this is not an announcement that you have to do, but this is something that needs to be done. These are prophetic instructions. Number 6, remember that most people's actions and deeds are due to what they are battling within themselves. Don't personalize everything. Instead, pray about everything, and pray that God would help you in this area. Okay, so those were prophetic instructions, prophetic warning. Examine your heart, guard your heart above all else in this hour. Proverbs 4:23. Send this to 5 to 7 people if it has blessed you. Send this to 5 to 7 people so that the word of the Lord can go forth and so that God's people can be free from the tactics of the enemy in this hour as we are getting ready to possess the promises of God. I pray that this has been a blessing to you. Remember, take this to the Lord to get further confirmation if this is for you. See you all next time. Be blessed.